And when you have the 18th chapter of the book of St. Matthew, looking at verse number 15, you can say, I have the word. We'd like to welcome our viewers. We are the King's Chapel Assembly, and we're located 703 East Jefferson Boulevard. We are the church in the heart of this city with you in our heart. We're happy once again that you've tuned in. Stay right there. We have a word for you this afternoon. Call somebody up and let them know that the Power of Pentecost telecast is on the air. As you follow along silently in this 18th chapter, Jesus speaks to us. He says, moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. If he shall, goes on and says, if he shall hear thee, thou hast gained, amen, thy brother. But if he will not hear thee, then take with thee one or two more, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. Verse 17 says, and if he shall neglect to hear them, tell it unto the church. But if you neglect to hear the church, amen, let him be unto thee as a heathen man and a publican. Verily I say unto you, whatsoever you shall bind on earth shall be bound where? In heaven. And whatsoever you shall loose on earth shall be loosed where? In heaven. Again, I say unto you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done, praise God, for them of my Father which is in heaven. Verse 20 says, for where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them. Then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how oft shall my brother sin against me, and I forgive him, till seven times? Jesus saith unto him, I say unto thee, until seven times, amen, until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Therefore, amen, is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king which would take account of his servants. Now, once you drop down to verse number 32, we're going to look at verses 32 through 35. Then his Lord, after he had called him, said unto him, O thou wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt, because thou desirest me. Shouldest not thou also have compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? And his Lord was wroth, in other words, he was angry, and delivered him to the tormentors, till he should pay all that was due unto him. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you, if you, amen, from your hearts, forgive not everyone his brother their trespasses. Let's bow our heads as we look unto the Lord. Dear Lord, in the name of Jesus, we look to you once again this afternoon. We thank and we praise you for the opportunity, God, to stand in this place. And we know, God, that even as your word is said, where two or three are gathered together in my name, touching and agreeing, we agree right now that this word will go forward. It will penetrate our hearts. It will give us, Lord, the wisdom and the insight of what you have to say this afternoon. I pray in the name of Jesus, Lord, that you would minister to every soul that is standing in this house. We pray for those right now that are hearing this word through the way, God, of the internet. And every time this word that comes back, God, we pray that it would bring a conviction and a compelling, God, that souls want to know who you are, want to know of your redemptive work of Calvary. We pray in the name of Jesus that you will come against anything that will come to hinder this word, oh God, to steal, to take out, to bring confusion. We bind it right now in the name of Jesus, and we pray today that somebody would go down in water baptism in the name of Jesus. Somebody be filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. God, somebody, God, that's fallen away would return back to you. We ask these divine blessings right now as we give you honor, we give you praise. God, we worship you for who you are, for all your majestic glory. We ask it in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. May be seated. Thank you, amen, for your patience in reading, amen, the text, amen, this afternoon. Let's give the Lord, amen, worship for who he is. I'd like for you to look at verse number 33, in which we'll draw our text from. Verse 33, shouldest not thou also have had compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I, praise God, had pity on thee? When you think about compassion, you think about mercy. Amen? I want to talk to your hearts on the subject here. There's no hiding your figures. Say with me, there is no hiding your figures. I wanted to use that title due to the fact here, when we look at it, Jesus speaks and says, the kingdom of heaven is likened to a king that has to give an account. And when you think about account, you think about numbers. You think about things having to agree. Amen? I wanted you today to look at this area of Scripture because I feel one of the great ways of being able to show forth the power and the anointing of God is to be able to take on the likeness of God. You can't be any more like God than you can be other than having forgiveness in your heart. As we look at this today, I want you to know that, and I'm going to use some terminologies here, but I want you to know that you think about unforgiveness, it has to do with a heavy weight. There are times today where we're living in a world where there is so much ungratefulness and unthankfulness. I'm concerned because we're living in a time where there, to me it just is, a spirit that, well, you just ought to do this because you just owe it to me. Some individuals even have that type of mindset when it comes to God that, they're angry with God and they're upset for their condition and they're upset maybe for perhaps the situation that they're in, but I want you to know today that God doesn't have to be kind, doesn't have to be gracious. He is that, but he gives his love toward us. The psalmist says, what is man that thou art mindful of him, and the son of man that he would even visit us? And I think about the scripture, God so loved the world that he gave. This is a beautiful story here because it really tells of two individuals that had a debt and that owed. The first one here, when we look at this, goes on and talks about how the Lord says in verse number 23, he says, why don't you read this with me? Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king which would take account of his servants. So he wanted to check, in other words, again, remember Jesus is the king of the kingdom, so we as stewards, we don't own anything, but God is going to hold us accountable to how we are managing what he's given us. So the king calls in these individuals and he says, I want to take an account of my servants. Let's read on in verse number 24. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him, which owed him 10,000 talents. Amen? My Bible talks about here, if I have the number right, it's about 3,840,000,000 if it were traded in the realm of silver. None of us can imagine owing somebody $3 billion or $3 million or, amen, $300,000 and maybe you got a $300 bill you're trying to pay off now, and you can't even think of that type of debt. But I want you to understand this afternoon that that debt here represents a spirit or an attitude where we have to ask ourselves, how did we ever get into this situation? I'm not talking about money right now, but I'm talking about a debt of unforgiveness. Unforgiveness is something that we have to deal with as human beings. And this is why Peter asked a very good question when he said, talked about my brother offending. And we see that there's a ministry of reconciliation because Jesus says, first of all, in the 15th verse here, moreover, thy brother shall trespass against thee, something we don't do, but the Bible says, go and tell him what his fault. Amen? You all see that in verse number 15. Go and tell him his fault between thee, and what does it say, and him alone. Which means what you don't do is broadcast to everybody how somebody did you wrong. You don't cry a sad song to the world and say, you know, sister so-and-so across the street did me wrong, and you put them, as the young folks say, on blast. But if you got a problem with an individual, Brother Sanchez, you want to hit that speaker there. If you have a problem with somebody, you go to them and let them know what your issue is. Which means here, the individual you hope would be understanding enough and have enough sense of compassion and sincerity that they would feel what you feel. When I counsel individuals, I say, and I bring two people sometimes into the office, or sometimes we'll do phone counseling, and it really doesn't matter if you don't see it the way the other person does. If husband and wife have an issue with each other, if the wife's upset, and somebody said if mama's upset, then what? Hey, amen, the whole house is upset. I said, well, mama don't have a right to be upset, but if mama ain't happy, ain't nobody happy. If mama has an issue, dad, you got an issue too. So whether you believe it or not, or whether you want to accept it or not, really doesn't matter, because if somebody has wronged somebody, if somebody has offended somebody, there's got to be a part of you where there's got to be tender and compassion enough to say that if you're hurt, then I'm hurt. If you have an issue, then I've got to get down to your level and understand how you're hurt. I've got to understand why you're hurt. If I'm the offending one, I've got to understand and know, what did I do to bring an offense? And sometimes this is a challenge, because when it comes to men and women, as you all know, anybody been married for a while, you know men and women don't think alike. Somebody said, I think men are from Mars and women are from, okay, is it Venus? Okay, they're from another planet. Amen. So you start to think, well, if you're on Mars and that person is on Venus, who's on the wrong planet? Amen. How many know it takes work to get on the same page? When we talk about agreement, okay, and again, I'm going to use some financial figures here and terminology here. I want you to know here, the figures are the facts. The figures are the evidence. As the Lord gave me this, and I didn't plan it like this, but the Lord gave it to me, and I was able to go see my wife and I the movie Hidden Figures. And I never knew that there were black women at NASA at that time where they had depended upon them. It was a great thing for them to be able to break the color barrier, and they had to deal with some issues. It was great for them to break the barrier of femininity. Women were in their place, and as we were called then, colored people were in their place. But they were so vital to the program going forward and getting man out of, into the atmosphere. Somebody say with me, figures matter. Figures matter. If you don't think they matter, you just go to the bank after you made a few deposits and then look at your numbers and say, well, wait a minute, who's taking my money out of my account? Amen. Years ago, unfortunately, when I grew up in school, My grandmother had an occasion where there was the bank president of Michigan National that actually was embezzling money out of her account. She had entrusted him with thousands of dollars to make deposits. And her eyes were open one day because as she went there, she knew what type of money she gave him. But when she looked at her balance, it didn't add up. I happened to be in school, in high school at that time, and the president of Michigan National Bank, I went to school with his son. And it got to be all in the news. And as you all knew, I grew up in Cassopolis, Michigan, and our television stations were South Bend. And so we had television stations there in my small town from South Bend. And it was all over the news about the embezzlement, amen, of the president of Michigan National Bank by my grandmother, Lavola Tillman. And she was shocked because this individual that she trusted was taking money out of the account. And after the authorities were called, he basically took off, was on the run, on the lam, as you say. And the FBI found him, and he was, you know, had to give an account of the money that he had embezzled. If you ever had anything taken from you, you know what it feels to be punched in the gut. Sister Green, I hear you say to be cheated. You ever put anything down that you valued, and you know how it is. Sometimes in certain families, you can't leave your wallet down because, Tommy's not saved. Tommy has a drinking problem. Tommy has a crack problem, and that wallet may still be there, but when you go to look in that wallet, amen, those Benjamins aren't there anymore. Jackson has made a flight somewhere, right? Amen. So the question of being able to trust individuals, amen, with things that we value are vital and critical when it comes to agreement. As I told you, I went to school, and it was a pretty awkward situation because the man who was the president of the bank who did the embezzling of my grandmother, I was going to school with his son, and we were in the same drafting class. And my cousin was there, and the other young people thought it pretty amusing. And I said, wait a minute, let me get this right. So your dad took your grandmother's money. And the boy was like, well, I don't know. Dad's coming up with cars, and, you know, there's a swimming pool in the yard, and we don't know where he's getting the money from. You know, you only make so much money even if you're the president of the bank. But he was taking something that didn't belong to him. Amen? I want you to know today there's something you owe individuals, and you owe somebody a debt, and that debt is you owe them forgiveness. It's a beautiful story because it goes on and talks about this man couldn't pay back the debt. It was just so great, and he asked his master for forgiveness. It was true that he owed the debt. It was true it was a great figure. But when we look down, let's look down at verse number 27. Let's read that together. It says, then the Lord of that servant was moved with what? Compassion, and loosed him and forgave him the debt. Again, we're not talking about money now, but I just want to ask the question today. Who do you owe love to? Amen. The Bible says, owe no man anything but love. When asked the question, whose life do you need to deposit in? Awful quiet in here. Maybe you got your thinking caps on, and that's a good thing. Since God has forgiven us much, we owe a great debt, amen, to individuals that are out there, and especially those that have wronged us. Peter uses the question, and it's a very legitimate question in verse number 21, because Jesus gives him instruction about forgiveness. He says, and he uses the number 7 because God's number 7 is a number of completion, is what the law says. And so Peter says, wait a minute, what if it's 7 times? Lord, should I forgive somebody 7 times? And he's talking about it one day. And the Lord all right, gives them a greater level of knowledge and understanding. He said, I say unto thee, in verse number 22, until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Well, again, that's 490 times he's talking about in one day. Now, I believe that it's totally impossible for somebody to offend you 490 times, 7 times 70 in one day. Amen? But the Lord was giving a principle. If somebody were to offend you, that same person, that many times in one day, you have to still forgive. Amen? Now, you might say, well, look, when they did it, it hurt. But as the story goes on and talks about here, that man had received forgiveness. And then there was another man that owed him money. And this man, even though I said he owed $3,840,000,000, this man here that owed him money owed him so much less, about $3,200 worth, if you were to compare it to silver. And this man who had received so much compassion, so much mercy by his Lord, was not willing to forgive somebody that owed him even less. The perspective is here that, first of all, God has forgiven us all of our sins. God so loved the world that he made a provision. Amen? Let's give the Lord some praise. He made a provision out on Calvary that all the world can have their sins forgiven. Amen? The debt was already paid. You have to also understand as we look at this here that you cannot, amen, get to a place of justification in your life by working at it. So when we talk about here this debt, understand here this debt comes about, amen, or what we owe, because God alone gives us credit. Jesus, when he gave us mercy, gave us a gift. We receive mercy here. Now, I'm talking about here grace. In this sense, grace being the unmerited favor of God, nothing you can do to merit or work for the grace of God. It's a gift. Stay with me. It's a gift. Grace is not earned. Grace is granted. It's a gift from God. We think about grace, in this case, it is unmerited favor. It is mercy instead of judgment. The man that owed so much, the Lord had the absolutely right to keep that man in jail. Because again, he owed millions and perhaps billions of dollars. Had every right to hold that against him. But we find here when the servant cried out, he said, have mercy upon me. And the Lord gave that man forgiveness of the debt. See, when you receive something from somebody, the way it's supposed to work, you're supposed to be kind and compassionate toward other individuals because you have received mercy. Amen? Let's look at this here. I want to ask you a few questions this afternoon, and this is a good time because we're taking introspection within our own life as far as a health checkup. I want to ask you the question here, does it add up in your life? There's another term when it comes to financial terms that's talking about proving something. When you prove it, you put it to the test. Amen? I remember when I was in school, I hated accounting. I didn't like accounting. And there was a lady who taught accounting and taught typing in our class. And, you know, it first started okay, but when she got down to all these other charts and you had to come down and both numbers had to agree, you know, I started out okay, but when it came toward the end, I'm like, how did you get this over here? And how does this come over here? But it's got to agree. Amen? You're not in right standing with God if you got something against somebody. You're not in right standing with God if you're holding grudges against somebody. You're not in right standing with God if you can't show love towards somebody that offended you. So does it add up in your life? I want to ask also the question here, what do you owe? How are you going to pay it back? When individuals have deposited into your life and you have been an individual that has been a recipient, what you have to be on guard for, what you have to be aware of, is that unforgiveness is somewhat like water. It finds its lowest level. Unforgiveness has a way of not just flooding our hearts, but making little increment inroads into our life. So it's an offense here, then an offense there. They said this and hurt my feelings. And then next week they said that and hurt my feelings. And if you don't address it, unlike the text says here, if you've been offended, the Bible says you go to him or that person alone, if they won't hear you, amen, and then you go, and through the hierarchy, amen, you go and you get two or three other witnesses. If they don't receive you, then you come to the church, which means you don't put the individual on blast in the church, but you come to me, the pastor, for reconciliation. You don't tell your brother and sister, well, you know, they ain't treat me right at church. No, you bring your issue to me because the poison cannot be put out in the church. How many churches and homes and families and institutions have been torn down because of a spirit of unforgiveness, because of a cancer of bitterness? Amen? How many people, amen, even have gotten out of the church, away from the church, because when they tried to rectify with somebody and make it right, somebody wasn't sensitive enough and said, well, you need to be more spiritual. That shouldn't bother you. We're living in a time today where I'm asking the question, are we doing what the Lord says here in this text? Because I do believe here there's no hiding of the figures. When I say no hiding of the figures, what I'm talking about, first of all, since the Lord has deposited so much into our lives, and since we owe so much back to God, the only way we can give back is that we deposit forgiveness into the lives of those that we feel have wronged us. Some relationships, and you might think, well, you know, when it comes to hard relationships with a husband or wife, you can forgive. That does not mean you have to condone what that person did. Amen? You can forgive, and sometimes you have to cut the ties and you got to go on. Amen? But it's more important for you, the one that is forgiving, because you cannot take prisoners. You cannot hold somebody hostage in your mind. Amen? If that person's name were to surface, you have to ask yourself, and thank you again, First Lady, for a wonderful worksheet that you put out, because she's talking about here feelings, and she's talking about spirits, and what do you feel when you hear a certain person's name? Does it take you out of worship? Do you lose your peace? Do you end up having a so-called bad day? When that phone call rings, and like, I was doing good till I heard from you. There are a lot of areas in our life where we need to forgive. A lot of areas. And the most telling part here, when we look at this, unforgiveness is not only like water that creeps in, but unforgiveness is also like leaven. We don't use that term, but leaven was never good in the Bible. It has to do, comparison, as you're cooking with wheat, like yeast. Yeast causes things to rise. So I would compare leaven here, not only to yeast when it comes to cooking, but I would also look at it like sin or like cancer. If you went to the doctor and the doctor said, well, that's okay, you just got a little speck of cancer, it's nothing to worry about, you would not leave the doctor's office feeling well about that. You would say, doctor, I don't care if it's a speck, I want you to do something with the speck that's there, because you don't want the speck to multiply. Amen? This is what unforgiveness does. It never stays the same size. And the speck of unforgiveness will kill your spiritual life. I do good with everybody in my family, but so-and-so. What are you going to do about it? When are you going to get rid of that issue? You know if you're forgiven, because whether or not you get to next week and you're still bringing up the same story about how they offended you. You say, well, I forgive them. But why do you bring it up again? Why is it always resurfacing? Amen. If you're really forgiven them, how come you won't let it go? Amen. When we look at this debt here, we have to understand that God has granted us freedom. We need to ask ourselves, how am I going to use the freedom that I've received from God, forgiveness? Amen. How am I going to interject that into the lives of others? Thank you, Jesus. When we look at this, I want to ask you a question here. Can you really live with that speck of unforgiveness in your life? Can you live being an individual who is used to receiving compassion and mercy and not giving it back? Sooner or later, what will happen, you will start to lose true friends. Because when it comes to mercy, mercy's like this. Mercy, again, and you all know, you've heard me, it's like money in the bank, and no deposit, no return. The opposite side of mercy is judgment. If you find yourself having a critical, circumspect attitude where you're judgmental to everything that's out there, nobody's right unless they see it your way. Nobody knows like you know. Spirit of pride and arrogance says here that you only know how to make it work and to fix it. Unless people come your way, it's not done right at all. So you put that judgment out there, but what you don't understand that sooner or later, there's an old saying, the bigger you are, the harder you fall. Sooner or later, individuals who think they have all the answers are going to hit the wall. And if they've been judgmental, if they've been critical, if they've put down others, sooner or later when they fall down and they splat, hit the ground, they're going to want somebody to have mercy and compassion on them. And guess what? They're not going to find anybody to pick them up. They're not going to find anybody to help them because they've only sown the seeds of discord and judgment. Therefore, in their time of calamity, they will not find any help. Do you understand that even the Word of God talks about God having a sense of humor? God, amen, search it out. God has a sense of humor. There's a scripture in the Bible, in the Word, that talks about God would laugh at man's calamity. Because man says within his own self here, basically, I don't need God, and that I am my own God, and the doctrine of humanism says I've got all the answers. And sooner or later, God has a way of pulling the covers off individuals, and everybody sees that the king has no clothes. Amen. And that individual that God humbles will then look up to a God that he's never called on before. She's never called on God before. And when he or she calls upon God that she never or he never depended on before, but rather mocked God, God said, I'm going to laugh at you and your calamity. Why? Because pride caused you to be able to feel like that you didn't owe anybody anything. I'm telling you today, saints, here, that you can't hide anything in your heart against somebody. There's no hiding the facts or the figures in your life. When it comes to forgiveness, we that have received it, we've got to give it out. Who are we to be able to hold anything, amen, against, the Bible says, the elect of God, because it is God that judges. Who are we to hold anything against somebody when, amen, even the king's heart, amen, is in God's hands. God said, I'm able to turn them to the right or to the left. Amen? So again, can you live a life, or rather, can you live always being receiving here, compassion and mercy, but not giving back? I don't believe so. I believe you have to give it back since you received it. There's a debt that we owe. We have to also ask the question here, do you understand what God has done for you? When individuals have been praying for you, individuals have been pleading the blood for you, amen, and you escape this and you escape that again, it was not luck. It was the prayers of the saints of God that God spared you because somebody was pleading the blood. Don't let by the fact that you didn't get immediate judgment think that you can get by. Should you continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. Paul goes on to say here, how is it that we that are dead to sin can live any longer therein? We must understand here that there's got to be a time of accountability that, Lord, you've been so good to me, I shouldn't be mean like this. You've been too good to me, I should not have a nasty, foul attitude. You've been too good to me. I shouldn't be running the saints down and the pastor down and the ministers down and the first lady down. God, you've been too good to me. Many times God allows us to get off the hospital bed and to get off the sick bed and to come out of the prison. And we think, well, I'm just going to do my own thing. No, the Lord heard somebody's prayer. Lord, have mercy on that individual. And since you have received mercy, again, the question is, what are you going to do with the mercy that God gives you? I want to ask you another question today. Are you a taker and not a giver? Do you want people to understand you when you scrape your knee, but when other individuals, amen, bump their head or scrape their knee, are you willing to put your arms up under them and to help them? Sometimes we have a generation gap, and sometimes we get to be older, we forget to remember that when we were 20, we didn't think the way we think now that we're older. Amen? The mind of a 20-year-old is different than the mind of a 50-year-old or a 60-year-old. Go back, amen, to when you were 20. Amen? Go back, amen, to the time when you were 15. Amen? Go back to the time when you were in high school. Amen? Many of us say here, if I could have had now, amen, back then, I would be so much better off. But I believe we can put ourselves back in the shoes of individuals that are generations before us. We can say, wait a minute, I got to deal with you on your level, amen, and at your age. And I got to try to understand what you're going through so I can minister to you the compassion, the understanding, the mercy that you need, because I got to come down to your level. Jesus comes down to the level of humanity. Amen. You all remember the woman who was sleeping around when she was known as a woman of the evening, and they caught her in the very act of adultery. Well, if they're going to do the right thing, they should have dragged a man and a woman, but they bring only the woman, amen, to Jesus. In other words, and they're saying, well, Jesus, we caught her in the very act, and the law says she should be stoned. What do you say, Jesus? Jesus begins to stoop and to write in the sand. Amen. The scripture doesn't tell us what he wrote, but we have to believe that the woman's accusers were called out in the sand. That's why it's dangerous for you to judge, because the same judgment you put out is coming back to you again. Amen. As he wrote in the sand, amen, the accusers had their rocks in their hand. They're getting ready, amen, for the Lord to give the okay that, yes, she ought to be stoned, but they didn't understand who they were talking to. When they dragged a woman to Jesus, they could not even comprehend, amen, that he was a God full of compassion and mercy. But he stooped and he wrote in the sand because he knew the intentions and the hearts of individuals that were bringing this woman. He knew their hearts. Now, I want you to understand today, sometimes people try to pin you up between a wall and a hard place, and they try to paint you with the wrong brush stroke. But if God has forgiven you, then who is anybody else to try to pin that thing on you? If the blood of Jesus is already covering you, amen, then what you used to be is not what you are today. Come on and give God some praise for the Lord washing you today. Amen, amen. And as he wrote, you all know how the story goes. They all started to tip out because, amen, even though they felt like they had dirt on the woman, amen, there was something in the sand that revealed, amen, perhaps what they did was also wrong. Amen. Come on, somebody. Amen. When the Lord has the handwriting on the wall, amen, I just wonder today if the Lord, amen, were to go into our homes and to go into our bedrooms and to look at our cell phones and our computers and were to bring everything out, amen, how would we come out? How do the figures look? I wonder today, amen, if the Lord, praise God, were to ride in our automobiles and if he could be a fly on the wall and hear the conversations of what we're saying when other individuals aren't around, amen, then do the figures line up? The figures I'm talking about, the words that are coming out of our mouth, are we talking about somebody and running somebody down? Are we saying, I can't stand that person? I want you to know, saints, today, amen, your figures have got to line up today. Amen. The figures are the facts. And even though, amen, you might feel justified of being wrong, but again, it's up to you to be able to go to that individual and say, look, you've hurt me. Amen. And I don't want to feel this way about you. And I don't want to have this sinking feeling in my stomach. In order for me to be free as a brother and a sister in the Lord, I got to get it right with you. Marriages are dissolved because of somebody not willing to get it right. Institutions fall down because of individuals not willing to get it right. Churches end up splitting because of individuals that want their way and another group wants their other way. And next thing you know here, because of pride and because of unforgiveness, things start to dissolve. I believe when we look at this here, God is saying here, we need to pay what we owe because the Lord gives us credit. As I told you earlier here, the Lord has given us, you might look at it here, an exorbitant amount of credit. He said, I've forgiven you of so many things. Do you understand the Lord has already made a provision of forgiveness for you? Not that we want you to sin tomorrow or next week, but if you do sin, amen, we have an advocate with the Father, the man Christ Jesus. Do you understand today that the only provision for us to receive forgiveness is in the blood of Jesus? Do you understand this afternoon that Jesus is not coming back to the cross? When he died one time for the sins of the world. And therefore, amen, if anybody needs to be forgiven tomorrow, we've got to go back to the one offering that was made for us, the man Christ Jesus, the Lamb of God. And that same blood, amen, that was spilled over 2,000 years ago, it's got to be the same blood today that takes away individuals' sins. It's a sin, therefore, to have unforgiveness in our heart here. And praise God, what better way can we be a light to the world to let the world know here today, since God has forgiven us of all of our sins and all of our issues, we're not going to hold anybody prisoner today. I said we're not holding anybody prisoner today. Amen. The most sure way to be able to miss heaven today is to hold something in your heart. Amen. You may try to hide it, and you may try to put on a church face, and you may lie and say it doesn't bother you, but God knows within your heart, if your heart's not right with God, when the rapture takes place, you'll be left here. Amen. God knows here, amen, if there's a speck of cancer of unforgiveness that's residing down on the inside, amen, that thing will keep you, amen, and prevent you from being able to make it in the rapture. Child of God, it's not worth missing the rapture, amen, or for anybody that's walking on two legs. It's not worth it today, amen, being out of the will of God. Amen, that person that you're not forgiving, they're not even thinking about you. They're going on their way, amen, and they don't, amen, even have an issue. Then you need to get over whatever they did against you. Amen. This individual that owed, amen, he owed him less money. But we find here as the story goes, this man who received so much compassion, he was not willing to be compassionate. And he took the man and he grabbed him and he put him in jail. But how many of you know what goes around comes around? Amen. When they heard what this man did, he said, wait a minute, I forgave you so much, and I loved you so much, and I wrote this off of your record, and now somebody owed you, and not you're not willing to forgive. Amen. It came full circle. Amen. The servants heard that and said, go back and get that man. This man that once had freedom was then thrown in jail. This man that once had a family, all his things were stripped away. And what I'm telling you today, if there's no one forgive, if there's, amen, no forgiveness in your heart, the enemy will come in and he will rob you of the very issues of God. You shouldn't want to be robbed today. You shouldn't want your home to be destroyed. You should not want, amen, for there to be a spirit on the job of somebody that hasn't done you right, for you to be able to know that you got to go back to that job on a Monday morning. You got to get over that issue. So now you have to do the hard work here of reconciliation. You have to do the hard work here when it comes, amen, to the offense that's taking place. And that's what we, amen, don't want to do. But how many of you know you really can't tiptoe around individuals that got an issue? Amen. Now, you can't make anybody forgive you, but the least thing you could do is go to them as a sister and brother in the Lord and say, I feel like you got something against me, and come on, let's keep it 100 right now. When I walk in the room, you roll your eyes, and when I rock in the room, you start to mutter under your breath. I just feel today, amen, if you're real with me, there's something in your heart that says you really don't like who I am. And I believe today if our churches are going to be healthier, and I believe today, amen, if where we go, amen, our places of employment, if there's going to be peace on the job, I just believe the Lord is saying here, we got to do it God's way. And God says here, you can't hide the figures today. The figure says here, I loved you so much, and you got to be able to love them the way I loved you. Amen. Come on, somebody. Amen. There's no hiding the figures today. There's no hiding the figures. When you look at the work of Calvary and you think about a God today that loved the world so much, and can I break it down to you, amen, to make it plain to you today? Amen. We got individuals that are running around today, amen, that are hating this Islamic, amen, ISIS type of mentality that's cutting individuals' heads off. These individuals today, they're not of God. And you might say, Pastor, are we supposed to love them? We're supposed to love them, but that does not mean we love what they do. That does not mean we condone what they do. And if I can digress for just a little bit, yes, the woman was caught in adultery, and yes, the law said she should have been stoned. But how many of you know when you get to Jesus, Jesus has got the final word. Jesus looked at the woman and said, look here, I know, in other words, what you're doing, and I don't condone what you do, but because Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, he says, go and sin no more. Amen. Praise God. In other words, don't go back and live like a whoremonger. I'm forgiving you, but don't take forgiveness as a license to sin today. Amen. Come on, let's give him praise in the house today. We don't believe this afternoon, amen, in unconditional eternal security, but we do believe it is conditional. Amen. Praise God. The prodigal son that left his father's house, he knew that his father gave him his inheritance, and he went out there and joined himself to the world. Amen. And he blew all his money. But he had something to fall back on. I want you to know, child of God, amen, when your heart, amen, has been rubbed the wrong way, and when individuals has burnt you the wrong way, you got to know today you got a God that you can depend on. You got a God that you can rely on today. Amen. When David did wrong, David fell on the mercies of God. David said that man ought to be killed. Amen. But when prophets said to him, David, you are the man, then what David wanted was mercy today. Child of God, let me ask you the question today. Before you get into the snare of tomorrow's test, and before, amen, what happened yesterday rises up in your life, amen, don't you want mercy today? And don't you want compassion today? Don't you want forgiveness today? God is saying here, when you look back at Calvary, amen, I've given you all kind of forgiveness. Amen. But now that I've given you credit, you got to go out and give somebody else credit. Amen. You got to go and let them know. If you're going to be like God, then you got to forgive them because I have forgiven you. Let's give him praise in the house. Amen. Child of God, I want you to know today, amen, that you can't hide it down on the inside. If God has set you free today, use that freedom to forgive somebody else. Since the Lord has set you free today, don't let nobody re-poison you. See, that's what happens. Sometimes we get free, and then somebody starts to whisper in our ear, amen, to bring something new as they think to our hearts. Amen. You need to let the enemy know. Amen. Don't come bringing that poison and junk to me. If I've forgiven you last week, then that's my business. I don't need to know what happened in 2016. If you're carrying some issues over here in 2017, you should have got it right when we ended the year. We ended the year, amen, in consecration. We came, amen, to the house of God and had communion. You should have already confessed it and put it up before the Lord. And now that we done rolled over here into 2017, I just want to ask you the question today. Amen. How is it adding up for you? Amen. How do you feel about your brother or your sister sitting next to you? Amen. If you can't love everybody in the house, I believe maybe perhaps we need to go back to the perfect law of liberty. We need to ask the Lord, God, is there any leaven in the house right now? Lord, is there anything in my life, amen, that's not like you? And we need to say, Lord, show me where the leaven is. Amen. Any bitterness, any resentment, Lord, show me where it is. If you're a true child of God, you want the Lord to turn the spotlight on you. Because the Lord said, I'm coming back for a church without spot, wrinkle, or any such thing. I don't want the Lord to come back and me not have any oil in my lamp. I don't want the Lord to come back and I got a problem with my sister and brother. Amen. It's not worth missing the rapture. Amen. Amen. I want everything to add up today. Let's give him praise in the house today. So the Lord says, I'm going to show you how to count, and I'm going to show you how to be accountable. When you look back at Calvary, the Lord said, I've forgiven the world of all their problems. Somebody's getting high right now, and God said, I've already forgiven you, but you got to come to a place of forgiveness. You got to receive my forgiveness. Amen, that you put the joint down. I've already forgiven, amen, the alcoholic. Amen, so when you go down to the liquor store, amen. Just because God has forgiven you should not mean you cannot go and continue to do that thing. But I believe today, since the Lord has given credit, I believe God is holding the church number one accountable. That judgment must begin at the house of God. Amen. If the sinner don't forgive you, that's the sinner. But you are not the sinner. You've got to forgive. You don't have an option. If you want to be saved, you got to get it right. You got to get that poison out of your system. Amen. You got to let the Lord shower you in his word. Amen. Now if Johnny don't want to forgive you, that's his problem. Amen. But every time you hear the name of Johnny, there shouldn't be something in your heart that says, I can't stand him. No, today, amen, saints. Amen. Just because you've been done wrong, God is not saying you got to love that thing, but he's saying you got to love that individual. God said, I loved you even though you were a sinner. I didn't love your sin. I didn't love your whoremongering. I didn't love you going out committing fornication. But I loved you beyond your issues. I loved you beyond your shortcomings. If you know you receive the love of God, come on and give him some praise. God said, I put credit in your life. Amen. I loved you when you weren't even lovable. I loved you beyond your four-letter words that were coming out of your mouth. So God is saying now, when you come to the cross, amen, the Lord is saying today, you got to be able to come with the power to be able to forgive. Come on and give somebody a high five in the house right now. What the world needs to see today in the church is the power to forgive. Amen. Too many individuals today and want to run around with a click and talk about this and that, but it cannot be in the church. It's not the old against the young. It's not the young against the old. But in the house of God, we are workmen together. Shame on you for thinking, amen, that you can't get along with that individual. I just want to ask you, where's your Holy Ghost? Where's the Holy Ghost God gave you? Do you still have the power today? If you got the power today, I don't care how much you shout and run around. If you can't shake, amen, my hand, you need to go back to the altar. If you can't, amen, shake, amen, Deacon Lewis's hand, amen, then you need to go back to the altar. Unforgiveness will allow resentment to rest in your heart. Unforgiveness will poison you. Amen. Unforgiveness will kill you sooner or later. But the Lord's saying there's hope today. Don't let the devil make you be out of balance with God. Amen. You ought to say, Lord, if there's anything in my heart that's not like you, I'm not going to miss the rapture. Amen. So many people today going to end up in hell because they were not willing, amen, to forgive others. And that person, you don't know, they could have got right with God and made the rapture. But here you are still going to be burning in the devil's hell because God said, I'm not taking people that have not forgiven. So, Lord, let me forgive everybody. Let me forgive the white man. I ain't got a grudge against the white man. Amen. I ain't got a problem with him. I ain't got a problem with Republicans. I ain't got a problem with the Democrats. Amen. I gave all my issues to God. And when you give it to God, you can be free today. How many want to be free in the house today? Amen. So let's learn to pray together. Husbands, let's pray with our wives. Wives, let's pray with our husbands. Parents, let's love our children. Amen. They might have been hard-headed. They might have got on your nerves. But those are your children. Those are our children. Amen. Let's go back to where they fell off the wagon. Let's love them where they are. Let's love them where they got hurt. Let's love them where they got confused. Let's go back and pour in the oil and the wine. Let's be that good Samaritan and say, if I got to put you on my back and carry you, then I'm going to carry you. The world say, come on, man. You can't do that. But I want to let you know today, there cannot be any hidden figures today. You got to put all the numbers on the table. You got to show the Lord your hand. God said, if you're holding an ace in the hole, amen, I get along with everybody, but that one person will keep you from making the rapture. Amen. Your figures got to add up today. So, Lord, I'm going to love my enemies. I'm going to pray for those that despitefully use me and persecute me. Amen. When the Lord called the church home, he said, I'm taking those back that are not holding grudges. I'm taking those back that are not backbiting. I'm taking those back that don't have issues. If you didn't get it right, then you should have got it right already. He said, if you got it all, go to your brother. Go to your sister and say, come on, let's work together. There's no reason for us to go to the same church and fight. No reason for us to have the same blood. Biologically, we are all kinfolk. Come on, somebody. Amen. Abraham said, we be brethren. Somebody's got to be a peacemaker. Somebody's got to be a prayer warrior. Somebody's got to get to worship. Somebody got to go back to the altar and say, Lord, my family needs help. My co-workers need help. You can't be caught up in their craziness. You got to be willing to say, Lord, I'll be the Messiah for those on my job. I'll be the one to be the example. I'll take the low road, God, that you would get the glory. Amen. Give your neighbor a high five and tell him, don't hide your figures. Amen. Don't hide it today. Put it all on the table. You got to be real. You got to be transparent, which means you got to change your language. You can't say, well, it ain't going to work out. You ain't even tried. You ain't even prayed about it. Shame on you. Where's your faith at? You never fell on your knees. Never talked to God about it. And yet you had to say it ain't going to work. Shame on you for not using the power of God. And we will pray about people as much as we talk about people. But I believe the church will be transformed. Come on, somebody. You may not like it, but the devil is a liar. Amen. And we will learn to get on our knees and say, Lord, you know everything that's not right. The old song said, Lord, you know whether I'm right. You know whether I'm wrong. But today I want to be right. Today I want to be transparent. Today I want to be clear today. If you want, amen, the Lord to say, well done. God is saying, come up out of your reservoir. Come up and give somebody forgiveness. Forgive them and say, look, amen, I don't want you to do that again. But I'm going to forgive you anyhow. Are there anyhow people, if there's anybody in the house today that got an anyhow spirit, amen, you might not have paid me back, but I'm going to love you anyhow. You might owe me some real money. Amen. And I'm going to forgive you anyhow. So it's better for me to lose $100 than to have a bad attitude. Come on, somebody. What are your issues today? What are your hang-ups today? What do you hold on today? What do you carry out of Egypt? God is saying, if you want to be free, you can be free today. But you got to use what I gave you. Use the power to forgive. The power to say, I'm going to help you and not hurt you. Let's stand all over the house. There's no hiding your figures. Look at your neighbor in the eye and tell him, does it add up? Does it add up? The Lord said, I'm an accountant. You can come on down, altar workers. And there's an old saying, you can fool some of the people some of the time, but you cannot fool God any of the time. I want to be in a place where I'm free today. If you ever had anybody drop that debt on you. Debt is a terrible thing. And you're weighted down with misery and sorrow. I can't get over what they did to me. They did me wrong. They burned me. We have a tendency to go into a shell and close up. I'm not going to love anymore because the last time I loved, I got hurt. I'm not going to trust anymore because the last time I trusted, I got burned. Can I tell you something, believer? You cannot be like God and not love. You cannot be like God and not be vulnerable. If you can close your eyes for a minute, look back at Calvary. And hold on, AV, we'll tell you when to cue this here. You look back at Calvary. He was numbered among the transgressors. And as a lamb that went before his shears is dumb, does not mean stupid, he opened not his mouth. And Jesus said, I'm going to stay up on this cross and I'm going to keep on dying. And because sin has no hold on me, I'm going to willingly give my life away so that others might live. I'll take on their sins. I'll grant them forgiveness. They deserve judgment, but I'm going to give them forgiveness. So today, if we have no forgiveness in our heart, we're still guilty of crucifying the Lord. Are you a murderer today? Have you used the weapon of your tongue against somebody? Nobody else was around, but the Lord was there. Do you know that every idle word that you speak, God's going to hold you accountable to that? So as you close your eyes and you think about this, is everything on the table right now? There's no hiding your figures because if there's something there, everybody knows it. But do you know it? When the Holy Ghost reveals to you that there's a prejudice in your heart, are you man and woman enough to say, Lord, I'm going to give it to you. If a man hate me, I can't be a man hater. If a woman burnt me, I can't go and try to get over on other women just to get back. Sooner or later, I got to get rid of my issues. Might have got hurt in the church. But in case you hadn't heard, the church is made up of people, not angels. The pastor is a human, not an angel. So, Lord, we're putting everything on the table right now. We're saying, you already know what's in our heart. You know why we do what we do. And if our intentions aren't right, and if there's something that's hidden, Lord, show it, reveal it to us right now. It's a dangerous thing because the Lord is asking, are you robbing me of love? Because when I don't give it to somebody else, I'm not just robbing that person of mercy and compassion. I'm robbing God. Because Jesus said, as you've done it to the least of these little ones, so you've been hurt, what you going to do about it? Are you going to forgive? Been hurt, am I going to work toward reconciliation? What are you going to do about it? The Holy Ghost charges the church to go back and to work. So it's up to you to have a willing spirit. And we pray that the person, whoever you may have to go to, would also have a willing spirit, because then we have what we call agreement. Dear Lord, in the name of Jesus, as we stand in your presence right now, and as we ask that you examine our hearts, we pray right now that your spirit would take control of our minds. If there are any jails in our mind, we open the doors right now and we let them out. It takes too much energy for us to be a jailkeeper to hold somebody. It's not fair to them. And it's not fair to us. We are just as much in jail as they are if we feel we have to hold them there. So, Lord, we release right now anything and everything that we may have held on to. We believe he with the Son sets free is free indeed, and the Lord is that Spirit. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Somebody say with me, freedom. Freedom. God bless you. Right now where you are, let's just worship the Lord. Go ahead, AV, cue this up here. This is your opportunity right now. If you want to come down and receive prayer, we physically have an altar here. You can lay here at the altar and talk to the Lord. If you want to be anointed right now, we'd be glad to anoint you with oil. Take your mind back to Calvary right now. He paid the price. Will you be man and woman enough to say, Lord, I got something in my heart. I need to forgive them. And I don't know how it's going to work out. But I need you to help me to work it out. If you want prayer today, won't you come? The effectual fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. Right where you are, won't you come? Lord, we go back to Calvary. Thank you for paying the price. We're not holding anything. Won't you come right now? Let's worship the Lord right where you are. If you want prayer, we'll pray for you. Come on down to the altar. We'll anoint you. Yes, bring it up, AV. How many know that Jesus, you paid it all? I want to be free today. I don't want any resentment there. I'm going to let go of it. I'm going to let go of it right now. Won't you come?
Change for the blood you shed.
Yeah, let's give him worship while we are. He paid it all. Hallelujah. Not holding any prisoners. Not holding any prisoners.